Well, good morning. Welcome in Jesus' name to our worship service. It's good to be home again, and I finally used my GPS to make my way back to Wisconsin. But delighted to be here this morning to worship. This morning, we had a great week of vacation Bible school this week. The children will sing this morning. Now, John, remember, just before the children's sermon or just after? Just before. Okay, so they're going to come up. They're going to sing. We'll have them remain here for the children's message. This way, it's kind of efficient use of our time, no sense in having them running back and forth. We kindly ask that you fill out the welcome card so we have a record of your attendance in divine worship this morning. And then you can pass those to the center aisle. Also, immediately following worship today, this is a really big responsibility. I hope I can count on you to help out. They're having a pie auction. And so we hope that you'll take the time to stay for the pie auction. I saw some coming in this morning. People look a little leery that I might hold them up or something. I don't know. But anyway, we hope that you'll be able to stick around if you have time for that pie auction this morning. Before we begin our worship service, would you kindly stand and turn and greet your neighbor? And if you meet a stranger, make a friend. Our worship service is printed in the bulletin, a little different theme. We've kind of woven into the worship this morning. Our patriotic theme, normally we do this earlier in July. But let's remain standing. We'll sing our national anthem. Please remain standing and follow the printed order of service in the bulletin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave me.
Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in his name, he gives the power to become the children of God and promise them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, though we do not deserve your goodness, still you provide for all our needs, body and soul. Grant your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your gifts, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading this morning for this ninth Sunday after Pentecost, Jeremiah, the 23rd chapter. Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says to the shepherds who tend my people. Because you have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not bestowed care on them, I will bestow punishment on you for the evil you have done, declares the Lord. I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them and will bring them back to their pasture, where they will be fruitful and increase in number. I will place shepherds over them who will tend them. They will no longer be afraid or terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up to David a righteous branch, a king, who will reign wisely, do what is just and right in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord, our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading is from, you couldn't do that separate? My bad. I thought the children's ministry of music. Sorry, John, I go right ahead. Now we'll continue with a reading from Ephesians 2nd chapter. Thank you, Jonah, for that song. Paul, writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, writes, therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth, called uncircumcised by those who call themselves a circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near for the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, has made the two one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace. And this is the one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who are far away and peace to those who are near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all that they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going, they did not even have a chance to eat. He said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. By this time it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it's already very late. Send the people away so they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages, buy themselves something to eat." But he answered, "You give them something to eat." They said that would take 8 months of wages. Are we to go and spend that much in bread and give it to them to eat? "How many loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples to set before the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 baskets full of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of men who had eaten was 5,000. This is the gospel of the Lord. They may be seated. Okay, great job, guys. That was it. I missed it all week. Next year, I'll go on vacation later after VBS. Have a seat. As any of the children, even if you were not here for VBS, they'd say, you're welcome to come up and join us for a children's sermon. Mom and Dad, Grandma and Grandpa, the little ones need some encouragement. Bring them on down. Think we got everybody? Okay, now, in the Bible, the Bible says, if we confess our sins, do we want to come and sit down? Or you can stand by me even if you'd like. Okay, in the Bible it says, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and he will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We even say that sometimes in confession and absolution. Now, in the Old Testament, God said through the prophets, I will forgive their sins and remember them no more. Let me ask you, boys and girls, how many of you forget things once in a while? You ever forget, I forgot. Okay, tell me, what do you guys forget? What kind of thing? You keep forgetting to brush your hair, but you remember to brush your teeth. Yeah, you got, that's nice, your hair looks pretty. What do you forget to do? Oh, you forget to do chores, you forget to brush your hair. What else do you forget? So, do any of you forget to take out the trash? Do any of you guys have to do that? Does mom or dad do that? Mom and dad do that. Do you ever, anybody have to walk a dog? You have to walk a goldfish? No, you don't have to walk a goldfish. Okay, but sometimes, what? A fish can't walk? Well, how does he get around? Oh, they swim, okay. I do now. Anyway, is forgetting, by the way, I gotta ask him, does mom and dad ever forget? You can tell Pastor, though. Yeah, you don't be afraid. They won't do nothing to you. Moms and dads, it's part of being human. Now, is forgetting a good thing or a bad thing? Is it good or bad when you forget something? It's bad. Yeah, okay, it's a bad thing. It's not a good thing to forget. Like, I forgot to walk the dog. Uh-oh. I forgot to take my medicine. I forgot to brush my hair. I forgot to brush my teeth. We forget. That's just part of being human. But I don't know that if you forget something, I don't think that's really a sin. That's just part of, our brains get forgetful. Now, boys and girls, if mom and dad, if they say to you, walk the dog, not the fish, right? And you say, oh, I forgot. That happens, and you just got to do it. Now, if mom or dad says, walk the dog, you say, no, I don't want to walk the dog. You want to walk the dog, do it yourself. Oh, man, you would get in trouble, wouldn't you? Yeah. And that would be a sin because that's rebelling against mom and dad, a violation of the fourth commandment. But forgetting happens. It's part of being human. When you're young, you kind of forget. And guess what? When you get old, you still get forgetful. Why do you think they have church secretaries? Because even pastors get forgetful. Yeah. Now, we've already established, I think, that forgetting is kind of a bad thing. Is forgetting ever a good thing? Sometimes. Like, give me one time when it's good to forget. Very good. Yeah, if somebody tells you something bad or they gossip you and you forget, that's a great thing. What else is a good time to forget something? Yeah. Sometimes we forget. There's some things, like if somebody hurts us, and we forgive them, it's better if we just forget that they ever did something wrong, like they hurt us or lied or made us sad. Gabrielle, did you have, pardon? When you get hurt, yeah. Now, A moment ago, I mentioned what the prophet said. God says, I will forgive their sins, and I'll remember them no more. So God, when we confess our sins, God is faithful, and he'll forgive us our sins, and he'll wash them all away. And when God forgives, he also forgets. That's a good time to forget, because not because God has a bad memory like us. It's just God chooses to forgive our sins and remember them no more, so that when we sin, we know that we are truly forgiven for Jesus' sake. Isn't it awesome that when we confess our sins, God forgives us, and he won't remember us, and oh, there you go again. Nope, God forgives our sins, and he forgets them and remembers them no more. Let's pray. Father, help us when we all have faulty memories, sometimes because of so many thoughts going through our mind. Sometimes it's because of our age. Either we're too young or too old, or some other things we forget. Help us to remember. But most importantly today, Lord, help us remember that Jesus loves us, that he died on the cross, that he rose again. Help us to remember that. Most of all, to remember that he loves us and forgives us all of our sins. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. You may be seated. Awesome song, by the way, guys. Speaking of forgetful, I just printed out some notes, so if I have one of those famous senior moments, I won't get off track. I want you to turn in your bulletin back to a reading from Ephesians, the second chapter. Verse 14, it's about a third of the way down. For he himself is our peace, that is Christ, was made the two one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing his flesh, the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose? To create in himself one new man out of two, thus making peace. Let's pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that in Christ we are one. Father, you make no distinction, because all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But all can be redeemed in Christ, our Savior. We are one in him. We confess that today. We pray, oh God, that you would speak to us in your word. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Dear friends of Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, we hear quite a bit these days, don't we, about walls. One wall in particular, build a wall, specifically along the southern border. For centuries, walls have been built around cities as a means of defense from outside invaders or even wild animals. It's been walls and nothing new. But that wall on the border is a subject for another time, another venue perhaps. But today I want us to focus not on the wall on the border. I don't want to focus on the wall made of brick and mortar. You see, it's the walls that we build that can divide people one against another. Such a wall existed even in the time of Jesus when he was on earth. This wall was an impenetrable, unscalable wall that existed between Jews and Gentiles. I suppose one could call it a virtual wall. It was a cultural wall, I suppose, a religious wall, a spiritual one, but it was a wall that existed in the world. The Apostle John writes in his gospel in the fourth chapter that Jews and Samaritans had no dealings with one another. Jews and Samaritans had no dealings one with the other. That could be said, by the way, of the Jews in the entire Gentile world. They had no dealing. In fact, I remember reading a number of years ago, the late William Barclay said that there are many rabbis who taught that God created the Gentiles to be the fuel for the fires of hell. Both the Lord Jesus Christ himself and the Apostle Paul dispelled such an absurd notion. There was that wall, an impenetrable wall that existed. And yet it was interesting, even though the Jews and Samaritans had no dealing, yet Jesus went with his disciples right through Samaritan country. Because he came to save them as well, to bring them in, and to make one new man in place of the two. There was a danger of such a wall existing within the church in Paul's time, a wall between Hebrew believers and Gentile believers. But Paul reminded the church continually, reminds us today, that in Christ there is no distinction between Jew or Gentile. We are one in Christ. If you confess Christ, if you belong to Christ, if you're part of the body of Christ, you are one in him. Paul went on to say in Galatians, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there's no distinction, male or female, you are all one in Christ. And he said, in fact, to the Gentiles, if you are Christ, if you belong to him, then you are now the Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. If you go back to Abraham, God said to Abraham, through your seed, singular, Galatians 3:16, all nations, all ethnos would be blessed. Through Abraham, through the seed of Abraham, that is through Christ, all nations are blessed. God shows no partiality and no favoritism. That's made abundantly clear in Scripture. God shows no favoritism, no partiality. Doesn't matter your background, your pedigree, the color of your skin, God shows no partiality among people. Now, to give a background, a little context to our reading from Ephesians a few moments ago, I want to read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10, to kind of give a backdrop of what Paul is getting at. Paul says to you and to me this morning that the readers of this letter, the Gentiles, he's describing in these words the condition of mankind apart from Christ. And he says this, and you were dead in trespasses and in sin, in which you once walked following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. Paul is saying we were dead in trespasses and in sin. They were hostile to God. We were by nature subjects of God's wrath. He goes on in verse 4. He said, but God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he has made us alive together with Christ. By grace have you been saved. You hear that theme a lot, don't we, in the church? Saved by grace. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So that, in order that, in the coming age he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ. I think every Lutheran ought to know these verses. Every Christian ought to. For by grace you have been saved through faith. It's not your own doing, it is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one can boast. Paul goes on to write, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. We are saved by the grace of God. We are made alive by the grace of God in Christ, not because of anything we have done, but because of what Christ has done for us. So that's the background, the verses immediately preceding today's text. Paul says, this is where you guys were. You're children of wrath. You're dead in sin. But in Christ, you've been made alive. Now, Paul writing to the Gentiles, therefore, remember that at one time, you can follow along in the bulletin. Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh, you were called the uncircumcision. By the way, that's what the Jews referred to them as, the uncircumcised. By those who are called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember, you Gentiles, remember that at one time you were separated from Christ. You were alienated from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise. You had no hope and you were without God in the world. But all of that has changed, verse 13. All of that has now changed because now in Christ Jesus, you who are once far off, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us of both one, has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of two, so making peace. What Paul is saying, God shows no favoritism. There's no longer a distinction, Jew and Gentile. That distinction is gone. That impenetrable wall has been obliterated in Christ, in his death on the cross. So what God's goal was to take Jews and Gentiles and bring them together in Christ, in his church, and make one man of the two, thus bringing the hostility to an end. Let me tell you, there's a lot of division in our society. There's a lot of division in our world. Oftentimes, there are sinister forces fomenting division and hostility. It's unfortunate. The one place that kind of division and hostility cannot and must not exist is in the church. Jesus Christ says, I have broken down any wall of hostility. That's why it doesn't matter the ethnic background of a person, the color of their skin, their race, their national origin. If you are in Christ, you're my brother, you're my sister. In Christ, we are one. That impenetrable, unscalable wall has been abolished, obliterated by Christ himself. Again, going back to Galatians, this is what Paul says. For as many of you, and all of you, I believe, here have been baptized, if not, see me after church. We could remedy that. Paul says, as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. I want you to understand what Paul is saying. Baptism puts on Christ. Another translation says it clothes us with Christ. Therefore, if you put on Christ, you belong to him. Paul goes on to say, there is therefore now no neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. No difference in male or female. You're all one in Christ. Ladies, isn't it awesome? You have the equal standing as men in the kingdom of Christ and the church as men. Ladies, there's no distinction. There's no partiality. Now, not everywhere in society in the world can you say that women have the same status as men. In the church of Jesus Christ, we have equality. And he goes on to say, you are one in Christ. And if you are Christ, guess what? It doesn't matter your pedigree. You belong to Abraham's seed, and you are heir of all the promises that God had made to Abraham thousands of years before. I started to say a moment ago, there are sinister forces that try in our country to divide us as Americans. They have a sort of divide and conquer mentality. They seem to be thriving on people being at odds with one another, dividing people any way they can to get people to be at each other's throat. You see it all the time on the evening news. To divide people based on race, ethnicity, gender, whatever else they can use as a wedge issue. It's too bad, when you think about it in our day, they've really corrupted the word community. Because you and I think about community, we think of the city of Amra, we think of the town of, we live together in harmony as a community. We get along together as a community. What's happened in our culture today, they've used the word community in a way that it wasn't intended, so that you're part of one community, he's part of another community, and this person is part of that community, and none of us get along. They want one community fighting for their rights, this community over here. That's not what a nation is. Jesus said, and Abraham Lincoln quoted him when he said, a house divided cannot stand. That's true of a nation, and it's certainly true in the church. Their force is trying to divide people in the country, getting people fighting, and they're doing a pretty good job at succeeding at that. It doesn't matter. It could be politicians, it could be academics, it could be entertainers. It doesn't matter. It could be people high in finance. They want to divide people. That type of divide and conquer mentality can easily creep into the church because there are sinister, satanically inspired forces that will divide the church when and how they can. We simply cannot accept it as the body of Christ. We are in Christ, and therefore we are one in him. It doesn't matter if an Anglo or an Asian, a Latino, a Lithuanian, Irish, or Italian, we belong to Christ, therefore in Christ we are one. You see, I don't believe in our country, one of the things I think is we divide our nation by communities. How many groups are sort of, not just Americans, but hyphenated Americans? I think that's wrong. We are Americans, period, and as long as we want to hyphenate, we're going to basically balkanize and separate and destroy our country. A house divided cannot stand. In the church, we are one in Christ. Therefore, there should not be hyphenated Christians. Now, I know that I'm Lutheran because I share Lutheran theology just about 99.9% of the time, okay? But I don't think of myself as being different. I'm first and foremost a Christian. I belong to Jesus Christ. I am a Christian by the birth of the Spirit of God, as are you. I'm a Christian by birth, but I'm a Lutheran by choice. That doesn't make me better or different than any other Christian. I acknowledge every Christian that confesses Christ as my brother or sister in Christ, regardless of what true Christian denomination or their ethnicity, it doesn't matter. Now, I believe in our country. I believe in our country. I think in terms of race relationship, I think we're doing better than we did 60, 80, 100 years ago. But there are people, there are sinister forces that simply do not want people getting along. They want to divide along racial lines, and I think that should be an abomination. Certainly should be an abomination in the church. I know when I was growing up, it was absolutely forbidden to, was frowned upon to see interracial marriages. And the fact is that doesn't square with a Christian confession. It doesn't square with Holy Scripture. You see, Paul reminds us in Scripture, Acts chapter 17, he said, he told the Gentiles, the Greeks, he said, the God who made everything in the world, who is Lord of heaven and earth, first of all, he says he doesn't live in these temples made by human hands, nor is he served, he doesn't need anything from you. He is the God who blesses and gives us all things. In fact, he said, God gives life and breath to every living creature. Paul went on to say, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that God has made from that one man, Adam, every nation of mankind. In other words, what Paul is saying, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, we all have a common ancestry, regardless of ethnicity or race. We all can be traced back to our heritage, our lineage in Adam. So what I'm getting at this morning, Paul says God broke down the dividing wall of hostility. In Christ there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, black or white. We are one in Christ, and the church of all places should get that message right and demonstrate that unity and that life if no one else will. The church ought to be that one place where we can feel safe from bigotry, discrimination, hatred, injustice, whatever. The church should be that one place of refuge in the world that, for lack of a better term, is a judgment-free zone. Not that we don't discern, but we don't play the judge. I'm not the judge. That's for God alone. Because, beloved in Christ, we have a common ancestry. We all descended from that one man. We have in Christ a common confession in Christ, who is Lord of all. We have a common faith in Christ, who saved us by his blood and redeemed us for his glory and honor. We not only have a common ancestry, we have a common hope in Christ and a common destiny in Christ. We are the church. We are the people of Christ redeemed. We are one. God has put an end to the hostility, and there's no room for hostility within the body of Christ. Not hostility, not hypocrisy, but the common confession. I want to close with some words of Revelation. By the way, this fall, if you've never studied the book of Revelation, this fall, when after Labor Day, we will begin a study of the book of Revelation on Sunday morning for the adult Bible class. I encourage you to join us. It'll be really encouraging and helpful and uplifting. But I want to close this morning with a reading from Revelation, the 7th chapter. Because this is a great inspirational chapter, passage. It's inspirational to me. Because John sees the vastness of Christ's salvation. And this is what John writes in the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. It's hard enough to see things that are yet to be. He said, I looked and I saw a great, after this look, and behold, a great multitude that no one could count, that no one could number. I want you to just stop and think of it. He said, there was such a vast sea of humanity, it was not possible for anybody to count them all. That's the vastness of Christ's salvation. And this vast, uncounted number of people were from every nation, from all tribes, and all peoples, and all languages standing before the throne. It did, black and white, Asian, Latin American, it didn't matter. He said there was a vast sea of people so great I couldn't count them all. But it was a very diverse group of people. Let me tell you, if you don't like diversity, if you don't like people that are different than you are, you're going to be miserable in heaven, probably. But it speaks of the vastness of his salvation, the diversity of his salvation, the desire that God shows no partiality. He said, I saw these people that speak various languages, various backgrounds, various tribes and kingdoms standing. And they were standing before the throne. All of them were clad in white robes. All of them had palm branches in their hands. And they're all crying out, worshiping, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, they fell on their faces before the throne and they worshiped God. Think of that, this vast sea of humanity, the diverse group that it is, worshiping God, saying amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. In the Lutheran Church, we understand the church on earth engaged in spiritual conflict and spiritual warfare. We call it the church militant. It is a very diverse group. But the church in heaven that John sees is the church triumphant, vast, immeasurable, and diverse, worshiping God forever and ever. In Christ, in the church, we celebrate unity, but we cherish diversity. We love people that are different than us. God made us different for a reason. God is not a boring God, but we are one in Christ. In Christ, that dividing wall of hostility is gone forever. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus into life everlasting. Amen. We're going to call in the ushers to receive our tithes and offerings. let's stand as we close our service in prayer this morning. Gracious Heavenly Father, you have declared in your word through the psalmist how good and pleasant it is when brethren dwell together in unity. May that be said of the body of Christ here at Grace Lutheran Church in Amro. Father, the Apostle Paul reminds us to be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit, the oneness, and the bond of peace. May that be our prayer, our passion, and our reality as the body of Christ at Grace Lutheran Church. Father, help us to outdo one another in showing honor, considering others better than ourselves, to have in ourselves the mind of Christ. He came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Father, help us to do what St. Paul exhorts us to do, to forgive one another just as God in Christ has forgiven us. Father, we pray that if there are personal walls of division within the body of Christ, you would tear down those walls. And we pray, Heavenly Father, be true unity, true reconciliation where there's been a falling out. Father, we cannot love and serve those that we cannot forgive. Father, we need to follow the example of our Savior who forgave those at the foot of the cross. We're exhorted in Scripture as the body of Christ to be one in spirit, one in purpose, one in heart and mind, to forgive one another, to bear one another's burden, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Father, help us to live out our faith that we could celebrate diversity, but also rejoice in the unity that is ours in Christ. To worship you together in the beauty of holiness, to worship you in spirit and in truth as a family of God in Christ. Father, thank you. One of the great privileges you've given to the body of Christ, the gift of intercessory prayer. And so we pray for those in divine presence today who are in need of your healing touch, need of your grace and mercy. May your hand be upon them. Guide us by your Spirit. Overwhelm us by your grace. Help us to cling to your word of promise. For those that are ill, we pray for healing. Those that have major decisions, you guide them by your word and Spirit. For those in financial distress, that you'd provide for the needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. That, Father, you could provide exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think. Father, we pray for those who are grieving. You bring comfort and hope through the resurrection of Christ. We pray especially this week for those who have been hospitalized. Ilse Oswald, Pat Bartel, may your hand of healing and grace be upon them. That in their weakness your power may be perfect, that they might experience your all-sufficient grace. Father, we also rejoice this morning with those who celebrate milestones of your goodness and mercy. And so, Father, we pray for Ron and Kate Bunkey, who celebrate their 35th wedding anniversary tomorrow. May your blessings abound them now and always. Draw them closer to each other, mostly draw them closer to you. A love relationship with Christ, their Savior. Father, we thank you. We pray for unity, for peace and harmony within our families, in our church, in our community, and in our nation. Father, we thank you that you hear and answer prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God instructed Moses and Aaron to bless the people of Israel, and he spoke these words, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace now and always. Amen."